Okay, good. So, excellent.
Is that all right?
Yeah.
We just start running.
Okay.
He saw you come in and he probably hit the cameras. You never know what's going to happen.
You are the man behind Moon.
I am yes. One of them.
You are one of them.
well, the director. Yeah, I am.
It's your idea. I mean, it's a really terrific film. I mean, it's the one that I was most looking forward to, and it pays off. It's like Rod Serling meets Solaris as reimagined by Peter Hyams or something like that.
Wow, I like it.
and it's absolutely terrific.
Thank you very much. No, we're very proud of it. Yeah. You know, little film, but we're proud of it.
Little film?
$5 million.
$5 million.
For a science fiction film?
That's awesome.
Sunshine was considered an indie, and that was $50 million.
I think. Dick Boyle.
He's English, too.
Let's talk about just the human condition for a second. Because Sam Rockwell's character either sees or doesn't see another version of himself at some point in the film.
Yes.
And I wondered, I was thinking for myself, confronted by the same situation, I might be a little more horrified, or I might be a little lovier. But what would you do in his place?
I think, you know, this Moon was quite personal in some ways, even though it's science fiction. It's very much my feelings and experiences of kind of spending time. It's no coincidence that the 3 years contract that he has is the same amount of time that I spent in graduate school. So the idea of being on your own, which, you know, I was in Nashville, Tennessee, is very similar to being on the far side of the moon in some ways.
I'm so sorry.
It was an experience, and it was a great experience because it gave me fodder for this film. One of the things that inspired me for this film was the idea of meeting yourself in person, and having the opportunity, you know, from different periods in your life, the you of now meeting the you from a few years ago or many years ago, and saying, look, you know, get yourself together, or, you know, you're actually a decent guy, you know. Just having that conversation between the you who knows more about yourself and the you who's maybe different or angry or frustrated or lost back in a younger, when you were younger. Yeah.
Now, the production design obviously is very important in a sci-fi flick. And, you know, some people I heard mentioning 2001, but I felt it really did owe more to that Outland school of 80s filmmaking.
Absolutely. Now, that was, you know, I worked with an amazing concept artist who was also one of the VFX supervisors on the film, a guy called Gavin Rothery. We've known each other for years and worked together for years. And the two of us have a very sort of similar sensibility and appreciation for films like Outland, Silent Running, Ridley Scott's Alien. You know, those are the films that we really kind of gravitated towards, and the work of guys like Ron Cobb. And we were just looking through material from those guys and saying, it should look like this, it should feel like this, and just really finding a way to bring those together in kind of a collage almost, and then try and put our own stamp on it as well.
It feels fresh and new to me at the same time, because I do like Silent Running. It's been a while since I've seen it, and that's something that immediately brought back up for me in that whole late 70s school. I was very happy.
Yeah.
In fact, even Gertie has a little quality to those Silent Running
Yeah, it's
robots.
Kind of in between Hal and Huey, Dewey, and Louie. You know, it's kind of in between there.
Right.
Yeah, so it's definitely.
And the voice is provided by...
Kevin Spacey.
Kevin Spacey, that's his
name.
It's interesting that you pick one of the most expressive actors to play one of the most inexpressive characters.
Yeah, I guess so. Yeah. Tone it down. There was a couple of reasons that I really, really wanted Kevin Spacey right from the start. Kevin Spacey brings, first of all, an amazing performance, but also there's this silkiness to his voice, but also this kind of malevolence there as well. There is this ambiguity. You never really know whose side Kevin Spacey's going to be on as soon as you hear that voice. And I think we wanted that right up front at the start of the film, is for the audience to be like, to think that they know where we're going, so that they'll be surprised when the film kind of unfolds.
Sam Bell reporting to Central.
Everything running smoothly.
Over and out. Rock and roll. God bless America.
Good morning, Sam. Do you want me to cut your hair then?
Lunar Industries remains the number one provider of clean energy worldwide due to the hard work of people like you.
Know
3 years is a long haul, you know.
I know you're really lonely up there, but I'm proud of you.
2 weeks to go, Sam.
2 weeks to go, buddy.
I'm going home.
Looks like we got a live one.
I'm gonna go out.
Okay, Sam.
Leaving Sarang working perimeter.
Send him outside! Who is he? You tell me who that is!
Perhaps you were imagining things.
What's going on?
Where did he come from? Why does he look like me?
You've been up here too long, man. You've lost your marbles.
Two weeks.
I don't understand what's happening. This is my mind. I want to go home.
I know.
Really, the content of the movie is what is significant because it does raise a number of issues and certainly a great little character study. But I do have a question for you because you have, at the core, you have this guy who's blue collar.
Yes.
And it's nice to see a blue collar guy rather than...
Yeah. Lantern-jawed hero type.
Fantastic. But, you know, when we get a hint of what he's like earlier in his life,
shall
we say,
yeah,
he doesn't seem like the guy I'd pick for the 3-year mission in space.
Well, that's a fair point. I guess you'd have to sort of just assume that there's a certain technical awareness that he has, or a multidisciplinary, you know, skill set that he brings that makes him the best person for the job, even if, you know, he may not have the best personality for it.
Right.
But he certainly was willing to take on the job. He was willing to take on the 3-year contract. Maybe it's more hard to find people with those skill sets to take on a 3-year contract living on their own on the far side of the moon, than you think.
You know, they say one person can change the world, and literally Sam Rockwell's character does.
There's some hard science behind that. So the idea of mining helium-3 on the moon is something which is real. You know, setting up lunar bases and the idea of being able to extract helium-3 from the lunar surface and send it back to Earth. This is all legitimate. You know, there's legitimate science behind this.
Am I going to prove myself an idiot? Because I had no clue. I just
no, no. That's absolutely fine.
So for all those people to say it's not hard sci-fi, it really is hard sci-fi.
That's really hard. That aspect of it is hard sci-fi. It's not being done yet, and the reason it's not being done is helium-3 is only valuable as a fuel for fusion power. And until we get fusion power actually generating more energy than is put into it, there's kind of this break-even point. It's not worth anything. But as soon as we get to the point where fusion power is actually a potential new energy source for us, helium-3 is one of the cleanest burning fuels that we can have for it. It doesn't leave as much radioactive waste as other isotopes that you can use. And a bizarre coincidence, helium-3 is incredibly scarce on the Earth. But is in actually quite plentiful supply on the moon.
Wow.
Interesting.
So, how did you know that little tidbit? You did your research?
Oh, you know. Dinner talk. Actually, I read a book by a guy called Robert Zubrin called Entering Space.
Yeah.
And he was, I don't know if he was if he worked at NASA or if he was just an advisor at NASA, but he'd written this amazing book, Entering Space, and it was all about how you would go about colonizing the solar system, but how you would do it in a fiscally viable, you know, way, because we don't have the Cold War in order to generate a drive to space anymore, and no one's going to do it out of the goodness of their own heart.
Right.
Maybe somebody from Microsoft might, I don't know, but you know, it's big money that's going to be required, and the only way to do that is if the actual space race pays for itself. And one of the first chapters in his book is about the reasons that we would set up a base on the moon, and one of those was helium-3 mining.
Wow. So a young filmmaker who still reads, and nonfiction no less. This is going to put you miles ahead of the competition. You are set, my friend.